One of the first people to worry about atomic bombs as a real reality was a Hungarian scientist named Leo Szilard. He had fled the Nazis after Hitler came to power. He had come up with the idea of a nuclear chain reaction even before nuclear fission, the splitting of atoms, was discovered. And so when nuclear fission was discovered in Berlin in late 1938, Szilard immediately thought, hey, you could probably use this to make a chain reaction, and if you could make a chain reaction, you might be able to make nuclear weapons. Scientists in many countries went to their leaders and said, you know, maybe this is something we should be worried about. And the person who did that in the United States was Leo Szilard. Nobody knew who Leo Szilard was in 1939, but they did know his very good friend, Albert Einstein. So Szilard went to Einstein and said, let's write a letter, and they ended up writing a letter to President Roosevelt that essentially said, hey, there's been these new discoveries in science, there is a possibility of a very large weapon being made. Somebody should be looking at this. Roosevelt was given this letter and he agreed, sure. He created the Uranium Committee, a very small scale research project where the goal is to just find out, are atomic bombs gonna be a problem? Einstein was a name that they were thinking of making on the Uranium Committee. You can actually find versions of their early notes on this, but then they cross it out. And they decided not to bring him in on the project. And they had sort of two reasons for this. One was Einstein's politics were pretty far to the left of what was considered proper at the time. And this was enough to get him a very large FBI file by itself. The other reason is he's an older scientist at this point, and the kind of work that Einstein did is not about practical, how do you build a plant to make enriched uranium. It's not that kind of physics. Even his famous equation, E equals MC squared, it doesn't really tell you how to build a bomb. It doesn't even tell you if a bomb could be built. It just tells you that an atomic bomb is not going to violate the laws of conservation of mass and energy, which is a useful thing to know. But it's sort of like saying Newton's equations don't tell you whether or not you can go to Mars or not. But they're useful if you are happening to go on the way to Mars. So Einstein's role in the project was a lot less than I think most people think, but he did have this one interesting bit at the very beginning of writing this letter. So there were hundreds of thousands of people in the Manhattan Project. They built an entire industry from scratch, and they did it in like 2.5 years. It ended up employing about 1% of the civilian labor force during World War II. So it's about 500,000 people total worked on this project. This is a big, big project. There's a lot of people involved, but there are a few names that jump out as being associated with the big parts of it. General Groves became the head of the Manhattan Project in 1942, and he was this just gruff West Point engineer. His previous sort of resume item was that he built the Pentagon. He knew how to get things done. And he didn't do it by being nice, and he didn't do it by being friendly, and he didn't do it by being erudite. And so obviously this is gonna put him head to head with university scientists, Nobel Prize winners. Groves's approach to this was the hiring of J. Robert Oppenheimer as head scientist. And you couldn't sort of imagine a bigger contrast between Oppenheimer and Groves, physically, mentally, personality-wise. I mean, they're sort of opposites with each other. And yet they got along really well as individuals, but also Groves had this sort of talent of picking people. He, at some level, understood that if he's gonna tell the scientists to do things they didn't want to do, it would be better coming from Oppenheimer than coming from Groves, because they would respect a guy like Oppenheimer. Oppenheimer plays this key role, not just for his scientific capabilities, but his sort of social capabilities, his ability to be a scientist scientist. There's a sort of another rung of people sort of underneath there. Ernest Lawrence at the University of California, Berkeley, major physicist, Nobel Prize winner. He had invented some of the first particle accelerators. He was in charge of one of the ways of producing enriched uranium. Enrico Fermi, famous Italian scientist, he was involved in a lot of different parts of the Manhattan Project because he was just that talented and his interests were that wide. So he was involved with everything from literally building the first nuclear reactor to aspects of weapons design. There are a lot of other people who are at different levels doing important and interesting things. One is Kenneth Bainbridge. He had been the director of the physics department at Harvard, and he was put in charge of organizing the Trinity test. One of the people who was an administrator on the project and also an engineer is Vannevar Bush. He had been the vice president of MIT and he was the head of the Carnegie Institute. And during World War II, he had convinced Roosevelt to basically put him in charge of organizing all defense scientific research during World War II, which ended up including the Manhattan Project. So he was one of the people who really saw the big picture. And then you also have some really big names of people who maybe they weren't as technically important, but played important sort of broader roles. So Niels Bohr, famous Danish scientist, came over in the middle of the war, encouraging other scientists to think about the long-term policy implications of these weapons. And Groves doesn't want any of that. He wants them to be very narrow, focused, technical sort of workers. The scientists don't like this at all. That's not how science works. Like, nature doesn't concentrate itself in these tiny little pieces. You sometimes need to know something about some other field to answer your question. The head of the Princeton Physics Department, Henry DeWolf Smythe, he was in charge of two different parts of the project, and as he later quipped, he was not allowed to talk to himself. And so pretty much every scientist on the Manhattan Project chafed under this regime, and pretty much every one of them ended up with stories about how they had to break the rules in order just to get their jobs done.
Wooden cabinet, you just tilt it over backwards, and the bottom drawer, you know, has a little rod that's supposed to hold, and there's a hole in the wood underneath. You can pull the papers out from below. So I used to pick the locks all the time and point out that it was very easy to do. And every time we had a meeting of everybody together, I'd get up and I'd say that we have important secrets and we need better locks.
Jean Tatlock was a girlfriend of Robert Oppenheimer's. She had sort of a stormy life, and she was close to a lot of people in the Communist Party. It's not clear she was necessarily a member herself, but she was in that orbit. She was credited by him as introducing him into politics. And Oppenheimer proposed to her several times, and she turned him down. But during World War II, she reached out to him and told him that she needed to see him. And he went to her while he was managing Los Alamos. And we know, because it was trailed by intelligence agents, he spent the night over there. And she then apparently killed herself not too long after that. And there's actually some interesting speculation by people who knew her and were around there, even within the Manhattan Project, that it wasn't a suicide, that this had been maybe somehow done by one of these intelligence agencies who did not think that the director of a nuclear weapons program should be associated with somebody like this. Oppenheimer named the first test of the atomic bomb Trinity, and there's been some speculation that it's sort of a vague reference to Tatlock. She had introduced Oppenheimer to the poetry of John Donne. John Donne wrote a poem about the three-person God, the Trinity per se, and that this could have been some sort of very out-of-the-way tribute to this friend of his who had died. In the United States, the president is the only person who can legally order the use of nuclear weapons. This was not always the case. Before that, it was being essentially run by the military, and Truman was sort of seen as a peripheral figure. He does get involved in the question of where to drop the bomb, and he is very crucial to the choice of Hiroshima, as opposed to another city that the military wanted to use it on, Kyoto. He doesn't sit there and say, should we use the bomb, should we not? That's a myth. He assumes, like everybody around him, that of course you've made a weapon, you're going to use it, no question. But President Truman did not take control of nuclear weapons until August 10th, 1945, so the day after Nagasaki. Most of the time, if you talk about Truman and the atomic bomb, you sort of end with Hiroshima and Nagasaki, but you want to start there, because Truman ends up putting into place so many policies that carry through to the present day, and he's more personally involved with some of these than I think people realized. It could have gone different directions. If you put a different person in that office, you may have had weapons be used in the Korean War. You may have had other places where the military would have had more influence versus civilians. Truman is very important in some of these key foundational decisions. After World War II, Oppenheimer was like a national hero. He was on the cover of Life magazine, he's on the cover of Time magazine. He became the symbol of what science can do. He's this head in the clouds theoretical physicist. Nobody would have thought anything he did had any relevance. And now he's the guy who's gonna tell you how the world needs to run if you don't wanna die. He never regretted using the weapons on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. He never regretted what he did at Los Alamos. He was very clear on this point. What he hoped would have come out of all that death was a new sensibility about how we have to not have wars anymore, and treaties and arrangements that were going to fundamentally rework the world to be what, in his mind, would be a more peaceful and better place. He did a lot of work behind the scenes to try to make that happen, both during and after World War II. And he tried to use this newfound respect to advance the kinds of policies that he thought would save the world. International control of atomic energy, basically banning nuclear weapons. He sort of spearheads that work in the United States and sets the terms of it. Trying to undo some of the secrecy of the Manhattan Project. He creates behind the scenes the whole declassification system that we still use in the federal government today. Pushing against the building of thermonuclear weapons, the H-bomb debate. He instead advocates for smaller nuclear weapons and having more small weapons as opposed to like giant weapons. And he's pretty successful at influencing US policy, but he's also going against pretty big forces. He made a lot of enemies. He made this both through his policy advocacy, and he also made it through some of his sort of personal style. Oppenheimer was a very clever guy, and he knew how to make people not feel clever. He embarrassed Louis Strauss in a congressional hearing once. Strauss never forgot that. He embarrassed Teller many times. Teller never forgot that. He accumulated enough enemies in enough places that by the early 50s, he was in a very vulnerable position. After the H-bomb debate, a number of the people who had been the winners of the debate, like Teller, they saw in Oppenheimer an enemy. And this was after they had built the H-bomb. They thought that the fact that they had built it proved that they were right and that Oppenheimer was wrong, and that not only was Oppenheimer wrong, but he was just an untrustworthy person and you shouldn't let him near anything to do with nuclear policy anytime going forward. A committee in Congress was trying to create an internal top secret history of the H-bomb. And they were doing this with the idea of showing that Oppenheimer had been wrong. In the process of making this, they worked with some scientists to make sure that they had the technical details right. So they went to a scientist who had been very important in the Manhattan Project, gave him a copy of maybe 6 pages explaining the technical details of the H-bomb. And he took a train from Princeton to Washington, D.C., and somehow, we don't know how, he lost them. This is a major scandal. You lost the secret of the H-bomb. This became this sort of major investigation. They never found the pages. They never figured out what happened to them. The guy who is organizing this project, this congressional staffer, he becomes singled out as like congressional staffer run amok. He gets fired. He had been one of Oppenheimer's enemies. The whole point of this was to attack Oppenheimer. And he starts thinking, who did this benefit? Who did losing these documents benefit? It benefited Oppenheimer. And so he writes a letter to J. Edgar Hoover in which he says, I think there's more reason than not to believe that Oppenheimer is a Soviet spy and always has been. Now, this is nonsense. Hoover knows this is nonsense. Like, nobody really thinks that Oppenheimer is a spy, but this becomes the opportunity. Strauss takes this letter, he goes to Eisenhower, he says, you know, I think we need to make a wall between Oppenheimer and everything else until we find this out. And this sets off this procedure in which Strauss goes to Oppenheimer and says, hey, we're gonna take away your clearance. And you can either just accept that or you can challenge it. You have a right to a hearing. And Oppenheimer says, I want the hearing, I'm gonna fight this. And this leads to many months of a secret hearing in which Oppenheimer and a lawyer are basically being confronted with this mountain of FBI documentation about everything Oppenheimer has ever done wrong in his life or any decisions he made that might look dodgy in retrospect. And there were many. And in the end, this committee decided that his judgment was not great and maybe he shouldn't have access to secrets anymore. And they stripped him of his clearance. He never really recovered from that. That was sort of, for him, the ultimate tragedy of his life, was becoming so influential and then having it all taken away from him.